Okay, welcome back everyone. Oh, I can take away this high-tech cover. There we go. Fill that out. So I hope you have all had a good lunch. Feedback's generally positive. The room's emptied. This is a good thing. No, I think everyone will come back in a few minutes. So this second part of the Content Delivery Summit, we're going to get you guys involved a little bit more, and we're going to sort of grease the wheels of that by having some discussions on a front panel here. And working up the OSI stack, the principle now is to look at infrastructure, the technologies that are being used to build CDNs, the techniques to string that technology together, and we've got some great panelists here too who are going to help us look at that from all sorts of different angles. We have had a few last-minute changes to the billing, actually quite a few, but... probably noticeably, Amazon haven't made it today because of apparently flu, but obviously Mechanical Turk wasn't working, so they couldn't send someone in to replace them on an on-demand basis, which is a shame. We don't have cloud represented, which I think is a bit of a shame on this session, but I'm sure between us as a group we can cover the topic. And I'm going to let Andreas introduce the remaining presenters and ask them to probably introduce themselves. So with no further ado, over to Andreas.
Okay, thank you. Welcome back, everybody, after hopefully a nice lunch. I hope you don't fall asleep. So, because the main idea of that session is to keep it rather interactive, especially for you to be able to answer all your questions. It's the infrastructure trends. Short introduction of myself. I'm on the content side working for Thomson Reuters as global head of webcast technology. It's in financial services, and we do about 25,000 live webcasts a year for our financial services clients. And I have been asked this morning which CDN we are using. I have to return the question saying there are not many CDNs we are not using. That is pretty much the bottom line for several reasons, and I think part of that whole day is showing pretty much that every CDN or every CDN provider has its benefits, some have the drawbacks. And I think especially for you, the session is meant for you, so you can find out if you're about to build a CDN or if you're looking for a CDN provider, that is your chance to ask questions, especially around that. May I just turn over to my panelists to just introduce themselves and the company they're working for. Keep it short so that we have time for asking questions.
Okay. Hi, my name's Dane Streeter. I'm director of Sharpstream UK Limited. We specialise in live event broadcasting and broadcasting things like radio stations 24/7 onto the web.
My name is Derek Goff. I'm the director of the content portfolio for Level 3 in the EMEA region.
Afternoon. Simon Orme. I look after our content services portfolio for BT Wholesale. We've built over the last couple of years a fairly large scale infrastructure embedded in the wholesale broadband network, which we offer as a service to our ISP customers.
Marc Latouche. I work for Cisco Systems. I guess if you have a network somewhere, there should be a Cisco equipment there. Looking forward for a discussion on infrastructure trends.
Thank you very much. Just let me start with some questions to all of you, and it would be great if you could give me a short answer. If you would look back at the last, let's say, 3 to 5 years of building CDNs or helping other companies building their CDNs, what have been the biggest technology change in the last years for you to, which enabled you to improve your service or help your clients to build CDN services on top of that?
Well, I'll start. I think for me, the most noticeable technology trend, of which there's been quite a few, has been the move to adaptive bitrate technology. From my perspective, it's transformed the end user experience. We noticed from a Level 3 perspective that when a customer moves to an adaptive bitrate solution from fixed bitrates, that you typically see an average increase of 37% in the average bitrate that a customer uses. So it's transformative, not from the point of view of obviously we don't mind delivering more bits. That's a good thing from our point of view, of course, but it's that's not really the point. The point is more about the perception of the end user quality of experience. And I think today, video online is perceived as a not inferior product to video over traditional terrestrial broadcast, and that's the great leap forward as far as I'm concerned.
Well, I would agree on ABR. I would just add also another thing, which I think is quite important, is the operation of the iPhone. One of our SP customers was telling us that 9% of its install base was iPhones, and the mobile data traffic generated by this iPhone represented 60% of its traffic. So 9% of install base generates 60% of the mobile traffic. So it's quite significant.
I think perhaps just adding on the adaptive bitrate, I think perhaps the other sort of macro trend we're seeing is the shift to HTTP, so sort of back to basics to some extent. And I think that's going to have a very fundamental impact on the structure and the economics and the whole architecture of the content delivery industry. So I think that'd be one thing. I think perhaps the other thing, which is perhaps a lot of technology, I'm not sure, but the rapid growth more generically of streamed video over the last 2 to 3 years has kind of probably underpinned the creation of these kind of conferences for one thing, but it's making a massive impact again, I think, in the way that content delivery is being architected now and will be architected over the next 4 or 5 years.
Yeah, I think for us specifically, the creation and installation on our network of Wowza Media Server was probably the biggest change for us, because it allowed us to encapsulate every single device and possible transport protocol that's out of one box with one input, specifically for live broadcasting. It really worked very nicely to have one feed in and multiple feeds out, rather than having to have multiple feeds for each event. I think it was probably the biggest one that we had.
From the last years to the challenges, what have been the challenges for you?
Well, I think a rather non-CDN specific challenge, or non-specific CDN challenge, I suppose, is the challenge of scale. The growth in consumption of online video content has been such that scaling to meet that is an ongoing challenge that never ends. And even for level three, who have a terrific infrastructure in terms of the physical locations as to where we might deploy our infrastructure, it is a operational nightmare trying to ensure that we can keep up with the pace of rolling out our CDN network, and even to the level of deciding up where is the next place that we're going to deploy. And when we're deploying in 30 locations in Europe simultaneously, just the project management behind that is a huge lift.
I think because we're UK specific, I think the biggest challenge for us was probably the expansion of the network versus the constraints of power in and around London area, at least, finding the additional areas at a reasonable cost was certainly one of the biggest challenges that we've faced, at least over the past 12 months. Obviously, that's going to change with the addition of new data centres in and around the area, but I think it's probably a short-term solution until a few years' time, at least.
Probably, just thinking back over the last couple of years, what have been the challenges? I think scaling has been less so, I think, of an issue, but I think the pace of change in terms of market requirements, commercial models, and some of the technology things we talked about earlier. I think if you're building out infrastructure the way we're building it out deep inside our network, our delivery cycles tend to be longer than software delivery cycles, shall we say, and I think, you know, the challenge that we see today, and I think we'll continue to see, is in a very, very dynamic marketplace, is how do we maintain the right trajectory and the right focus of putting the right technology in the right place, deployed in the right way to serve particular market requirements in a marketplace that is moving very, very quickly. So it's sort of keeping your eye on the target while the target is moving quite quickly. I think that those are probably challenges from an operator that we see.
I could add, on top of scaling, the fact also that we have a multiplicity of end device, which each of them which have different protocols. I mean, EBR was mentioned. Now, obviously, you want to support Apple, you want to support Microsoft, you want to support Adobe, and then you have to support multiple EBR technologies, which means in terms of content, you end up to create thousands of similar copies of the content using different protocols, which is a bit in addition to the scaling that was mentioned, I believe.
What would you say is the technology trend in terms of, coming back to our topic, which will make the biggest difference for you, let's say, in the next 12 to 24 months?
So I think one of the sort of key technology drivers that's out there in the marketplace today, and a big debate amongst the industry, is the whole story about interoperability. So we see a world where increasingly the heavy lifting of large object delivery will take place from within operator networks, because that's the most economic place for that to happen. The business model around that, there are many different ways that could happen. It could be licensing models, could be build models, could be acquire models. But the actual location of the point of serving content, we believe, will move increasingly into operator networks, because all the economics point in that direction. But if you paint out that scenario, then you have to have, sitting over that, a kind of open interoperability architecture to allow the abstraction of control plane technologies that content providers interact with. So I think that the emergence of that abstraction of control plane from serving infrastructure and the interoperability standards or technologies that sit between those two layers is going to be one of the key things we'll see emerge over the next 24 months.
Yeah, I don't disagree with that, Simon. The only thing I think is slight disagreement on might be the timescales. I think that would be. I agree with you. I think ultimately there's some commercial questions around how the model works. But to some degree, if not a large chunk of the heavy lifting of content delivery has to be done at the operator level, like I mentioned earlier on. But I still struggle to see it over the next 12 to 24 months. There's just the gel around it isn't there, an awful lot of the operators don't have, most operators aren't far along like you in terms of building an infrastructure that they want to operate themselves, let alone joining them up to other operators. So I think for me, looking at that, just that defined period of 12 to 24 months, the technological shifts, I don't really see a massive one. I find the biggest technological shifts have happened over the years when there's been a move from one existing format standard to the next. And it's rather like the video games industry which moves in cycles and steps rather than in a linear fashion. And I think that, we've kind of just come through a step with a move to adaptive and with the move to HTTP. And I don't foresee a step change in formats or delivery protocols over the next 12 months or maybe even 24 months, although I hesitate to look that far out. I don't really see a massive big technological shift. I think basically next year, as I look at it now, the challenges that I see very much focus around the volumes of content. I think the Olympics are going to be the biggest event that the internet has ever seen. And I think it'll be a case of working with what we have today technologically to try to make that happen.
Yeah, I think from a different perspective, biggest technological change I can see, if it develops correctly, I think will be the future of HTML5 and what happens in and around that in that space in terms of the codecs and things that are used, whether that will change the industry formats that will then be used as standard for encoding, and how that will affect live broadcasting as well, whether the trend of usually using things like Adobe Flash will then start to move over to just a straight HTML5 live if and when that happens.
I would say on my side that more from a vendor point of view, not from a provider point of view, that we believe there would be no maybe major changes, but a lot of efficiencies that needs to happen. The way that we see that within Cisco is to see how the network can actually accelerate this move. And you know, we do see that sometimes a lot of the technologies is working on separate appliance, and a lot of the functions of those appliances could be inserted in the routers and the switches in order to actually provide a better response. I mean, an example is just the caches, where you know now we can have caches that are actually inserted in a router and would be able to work much faster than a separate appliance. So more on how we can optimize and simplify the current solutions rather than a big change.
Thank you. Are there any questions from the room? Please raise your hands. Oh, over there. Just give you a microphone.
I haven't got my bikini on, but I'll pretend to be the glamorous.
Given how much video traffic CDNs are responsible for delivering, should they have a role in defining and driving the protocols and standards? Particularly thinking about the fact that HTML5 missed a trick by not defining protocols or video codec standards, is there an opportunity for CDNs as a group to somehow be involved in the ratification of those kind of standards?
So I'll talk to that one, Jonathan. I don't really think so, to be honest. This is kind of more a personal perspective rather than a level three position, one way or another. I would look at the value chain as a kind of a continuum, you know, and I would certainly see the formats and the developments of the formats and the technologies around those that are closer to the content end of the spectrum rather than the eyeball end of the spectrum. So certainly over the years, my impression has been that the spur for innovation in the player technologies has been the content developers rather than, not the infrastructure players, and I think that's a good thing. The content developers are the people who understand the audience, who understand the functionality that the players should have in an ideal world to spur greater adoption among the consumers. And I think that the technology partners and the Microsofts and Adobes of this world are fairly receptive to that and very in tune with that. And they work with the large global content providers to understand what they want to see in the next iteration of their players and technologies, and that to me is a good thing, that it comes from the content side rather than the technology or the infrastructure side.
I think it's a really interesting question, actually, and I tend to agree with what Derek says. Fundamentally, I think this is a content provider to end user debate, but I think there is a part to play of the infrastructure providers, if the infrastructure providers, the delivery, the logistics industry, if we want to call it that, have some value to add in both influencing how various new innovations might work, and perhaps particularly the economics of how they might work. So as we start to look at, the implications of adaptive bitrate, both from an end user and an economics point of view, I think a lot of content providers are looking at adaptive bitrate versus, for instance, capped variable bitrate, as a different way of approaching kind of similar issues. Each one of those has very, very different implications from a delivery and network perspective. And I think as we move from a world where streamed, TV is, 5, 10, 20% of traffic, to a world where it's 60, 70, 80% of traffic, and the internet is actually becoming a video network, then there probably is a bigger role to play in a wider debate, around issues like protocols and services and the technologies that sit around that. So I think there's a role to play, but not, if you like, a veto or a or a decision in that way.
Another question over there?
Yeah, I think a CDN should be more involved, because if you look at the discussion about HTTP adaptive streaming versus true streaming, etc. I think the debate has been a bit biased by the CDNs who prefer to use caching technologies instead of all the streaming technologies, while a lot of content owners still prefer to work with RTMP and RTSP to go beyond the quality of experience and really get quality of service in the networks. Sorry. The other thing is that when we saw HTTP adaptive streaming coming into the market, a lot of CDNs actually had a lot of problems with session reporting and with log processing. We saw a lot of CDN operators out there who have not been able to bill their customers, which is great for the content owners, because of the extreme increase in logs because of this HTTP streaming, which is something that Microsoft and Apple and Adobe just hadn't thought about. And I think that's very important to have a better debate between those vendors and the CDNs to discuss those features as well.
I think it's an interesting point. I think it also goes back to the point Mark was making earlier around multi-device. So when you start to look at the implications of adaptive bitrate in a context where the number of devices is also fragmenting and multiplying massively, the implications, you know, around how you manage your origin infrastructure, for example, are absolutely massive. And there are lots of things that at the service layer, you know, one can do to mitigate that. But there's definitely a dialogue to be had, I think, around that.
Yeah, I think it's an interesting point, Steph. I hadn't thought about it in that way before, but I can't really speak for the other CDN vendors, and maybe they did, maybe they were very, very enthusiastic to see a move to HTTP. But certainly from a level three perspective, we think, a move to HTTP is good in that the operational aspects behind it become much easier. But definitely I can tell you that from our perspective, far, far too much is made of the argument that HTTP transforms the economics of the industry. It really doesn't. It's the licensing aspects around proprietary formats versus HTTP are in the scheme of things are not a significant cost driver for us, and I wouldn't think for any of my competitors either. But it is easier to operationally manage. But I can certainly say I don't feel that we've either had the opportunity to or actually exerted any influence on that move to HTTP. It was driven by industry factors, and from my perspective, more from the content owner side than from the content delivery guy side. But it's an interesting point nonetheless. It could be that other people other than level three had more of an impact on it than we managed, you know.
Further questions?
So guys, Andres, I'm going to chip in with a question here. So just looking on the title, we've got Death Star Distributed TDN or Cloud. So just to be clear, when I wrote the title here, just to be clear what those my picture of those core four architectures are, and that'll help frame the question. So a Death Star, I used to run a small CDN in the UK. We had two nodes. It's very similar, I think, to Dane's architecture, because largely he took over the legacy of my CDN. So it's a small distributed cluster of media servers, well positioned topologically in a peering point or across a peering point, diverse locations for fire and water redundancy and that sort of thing, but very, very centralized, which is kind of not what most people think of as a CDN. You think of a CDN as just being Akamai, loads of servers everywhere, not necessarily coherently done, but loads of servers everywhere. I'm not meant to slate Akamai there. But so the second model is the distributed one, the typical view of a CDN, which is loads of servers everywhere trying to get content out there. And typically, that was the historical model for a CDN. The idea was that long-haul networks were expensive in the late 90s. It was expensive to backhaul loads and loads of streams to yahoobroadcast.com. So they built servers over here. They built a proxy server, and they started calling it a CDN, hence the distributed architecture model. Then we've seen telcos and operators and access networks implement the same thing. I've tried to coin this phrase telco distribution network. I think actually everyone's using operator CDN. It's probably a more useful term. And that's something like a telco where they've got their own footprint and they're doing distribution internally. To me, that says they might have had historic problems with their own internal buying power and they're trying to buy distribution more cheaply. I don't know. And then lately, we've seen the cloud model, and it is a real shame in my mind that Amazon or Rackspace, we couldn't get a cloud representative here at the table today, because I certainly think at the lower end of the market, and I'm putting this to you guys, I think at the lower end of the market, the DIY infrastructure as a service cloud model is quite serious competition for the SME level. You know, when I started my CDN in 2001, it was a dark art. We needed to get a feed out to 10,000 people, 5,000 people. We were lucky enough to know how to do it, so we could sell the service. These days, you can pretty much point and click on Amazon Web Services, fire up an FMS or a Wowser server or whatever it is, and you can build and do it yourself. And I think that's having an effect on the bottom end of the market for the small websites that are trying to do a little event, for the medium company who just does a little bit of transient video. Great, they can build it themselves without too much overhead, without taking having to manage risk in terms of capacity planning and so on. So with that picture in mind, and having spoken a little bit about cloud, I just wanted to throw a question at you guys a little, and talk about what effect you see cloud having, and whether the SME level, or even at the big level, the big broadcaster level, whether you see Richard suddenly going, you know what, I don't want to do this anymore, I'm going to move it all over to Amazon, and I'm only going to pay for exactly what I use, and when I'm not using it, I'm not going to have to pay. Don't need to do any capacity planning, we'll push that onto Amazon. Do you see virtualization and cloud as the next trend? You know, these are centralized data centers, they don't have the proximity, but perhaps they don't need it because the fiber networks have changed in the last 10 years. So there's probably a load of stuff to talk about there, but that's my range of questions.
I think cloud from our perspective, Dom, it's almost a help and a hindrance. Obviously, for smaller broadcasters looking to do their own little live event, yes, they could go there and do it themselves. I think SMEs, in terms of some people like Sharpstream, can help in terms of the value-added services that we give on top of that small live event. But I also think that the cloud infrastructure level allows us to almost be flexible and use their network in a way, because we are so agnostic and centralised that if, for example, we do get someone come towards us and say, yes, we want to deliver 20, 30,000 concurrent streams to the web, then, you know, we can set our systems up to actually use something like the Amazon Cloud Service and be dynamic in that regard, so that we can do that one event to everyone and then bring it back in-house to manage our underscoring costs, really.
Yeah, that's quite a big question there, Dom. I'm not sure which end to start at. So it's kind of position that it's, you're totally right, it's kind of position that it's for the lower end guys and the DIY guys and the SME guys, but my sense is that they're exactly the guys who don't necessarily have the skill set to the in-house resources to manage the kind of the cloud model themselves. I personally think that you're better off to work with a more regional partner that you can actually talk to, mm-hmm. such as Dean and his colleagues, at that level where they can basically advise you and work with you. And then the question then becomes one of economics. And from my perspective right now, the CDN market has seen such aggressive commoditization over the last couple of years that the differential between a cloud-based service and the kind of fully operated service that ourselves or Akamai or Limelight would provide has become very small indeed at every level. So that means that a partner, an expert in the area such as these guys, could get relatively similar prices with one of the global CDNs and work with them as a partner or reseller. And then you move to the middle section of the market where they've got more and more resources, and they're able to do more stuff themselves, but kind of maybe focus on the sweet spot of their content piece. And for them, it definitely makes more sense to be working with one of the professionally operated CDNs, I think. And then you get to the top end of the spectrum, and you've actually come full circle, because if you're Richard and people at that tier, you're actually really looking at a CDN and going, you know what, I could do virtually everything that I would imagine I would want to do myself with my own level of resources, and I really don't need an awful lot from you, Mr. CDN, other than reliability, economics, and a good operating model, right? So at that level, I don't think that type of customer would want the cloud model either, because they're large enough, resourced enough themselves that they can use their leverage with any of the top CDNs to effectively drive even the roadmap of the CDNs, and, you know, effectively people like Richard tell us what to do, right? So I think it definitely does have a place, the cloud type model. I think it works extremely well for companies in the ecosystem who have a decent level of resource themselves and want to try out a fairly flexible arrangement in the cloud. But I do think that the use case is increasingly limited. It was once that it was cheaper to DIY, and that was the argument. Now I'm not so sure.
Yeah, as you say, it's a huge question, and I just don't think how to tackle it. So I think in the way you asked it, which is probably not how I'm going to answer it, actually, but I'll perhaps tip on that first. I kind of agree with Derek that I think in the way you asked it, I think the cloud model has some applicability to the lower end of the market. It has some applicability as a kind of part of a load balancing strategy. But I kind of agree with Derek that a lot of the people that it will be targeted at probably don't have the resources to make the most out of it. I think that's the way you asked it, I think. But if I step back and try and answer the question kind of more broadly, I might start by saying it depends what you mean by cloud. If we mean cloud kind of as the way I articulate it, which is on-demand infrastructure, then I think I go back to what I was describing earlier, which is a world where the large-scale infrastructure, the heavy lifting of large-scale object delivery, increasingly we see being done by people who have the kind of infrastructure that they can make available on demand. Now, at the IT level, a company like Amazon absolutely has that. At the network level, that tends to be large network operators who can create the infrastructure and make it available in an on-demand business model, in an on-demand way. But I think the other part of the question is what happens in the midterm at the services layer. And I think in a way that's equally an interesting point. And I think as we start to look at all of the increasingly rich and sophisticated layer of services that content providers want from CDNs, specifically focused around either application delivery or around video streaming applications, then those kind of services being made available in an abstracted way from a cloud type hosted infrastructure, I could absolutely see that model. And then when I was describing earlier about the heavy lifting being done in the network, that's an infrastructure on demand model. When I look at the way these services, I see these services being consumed in the midterm, that's a software as a service model. And the only question in my mind is how do those two things interoperate? And then the other question in my mind is the point that Derek raised earlier is when can that happen? But I think that's, in my mind, the absolute trend, absolute way the market is going.
Maybe a comment on my side. When we say that the cloud is for SMBs, it's a pity that the guy from Amazon is not there, because I think I recall that Netflix decided to port some of the applications to Amazon. So obviously, we do see some of those trends of big corporations thinking to use cloud. Having said that, they had problems to port it, because when you move a legacy application to a virtualized environment, there could be technology issues, but that was more technology issues when you move an application to a virtual environment. From a Cisco point of view, we believe that yes, clouds and on-demand computing is definitely a trend of the future. Probably yes, enterprise will start by some small deployments, but on the enterprise and on the media, we start to see some major companies starting to use that sort of technologies, and definitely from a cost point of view, it's quite attractive. The other point is, somehow I'm a bit not okay with the fact of say telco or cloud, because we do have as well a lot of telcos that understood that Amazon was a good business and start themselves to deploy on-demand solutions. The question would be whether those telcos will be able to provide the same services on Amazon, and even a bit better, because that was the point raised by Simon, and I agree, is that it's very difficult to link the application without the network. And definitely, a telco has the capability to link the application on the cloud and the delivery over the network. So that would be, I think, some interesting dynamics to see how on Amazon and others, we talk about the Microsoft orders, how they will face the new business models of telcos deciding to deploy the sort of technologies for their own services.
That's a very good point. That is completely true. There are certain applications that on demand, so maybe pure content delivery isn't the example, but there are other things that are in the content ecosystem that are absolutely suited to delivery in the cloud, yeah. Like encoding or transcoding, yes, or whatever. Totally on demand services. Origin services, exactly right. So yeah.
Further questions? In that case, I'm going to ask one more. Can you, from BT point of view or from Cisco point of view, I know you have done a project with Cisco to roll out Cisco technology in BT, and I have recently read a press announcement. You did a similar thing with China Telecom. Are you able to tell us a little bit more background, the reasoning, why that makes sense for those two operators to start implementing Cisco technology?
I'm not aware of China Telecom.
but probably BT is something you can answer, right?
I can give you a quick snapshot of what has been quite an interesting journey. So I guess we had two drivers that we were looking at kind of way back 2008, 2009, that kind of time frame when we partnered with Cisco to deploy this infrastructure. So one was an internal use case around how our customer in BT retail, bear in mind reiterating I sit in our wholesale layer, so all retail ISPs are my customers. So one was an internal use case around how our retail television operation wanted to re-engineer the way they manage the delivery of content, particularly in the light of hybrid, what is increasingly called hybrid IPTV models such as UView emerged, was going to require a very, very different way of managing content delivery in the network. So that was one driver, and the other driver that we saw was the emergence of other of our ISP customers looking to better manage how content is delivered in their access networks. So those are kind of the two drivers, if you like, an internal and an external use case. We determined to deploy a large-scale content delivery infrastructure embedded in the broadband architecture. This is quite different from the way CDNs are traditionally deployed. So it's kind of one of the key things here is how you manage capacity. So it's quite interesting the way, if one thinks of traditional content delivery in a network, there are many, there's often an assumption that the access network is just going to be there to receive it. And in large-scale, planned, predictable activity, that's usually the case. But the problem with video delivery on the internet is that often many, many things are unpredictable. Peaks can be very, very large. Traffic demand can occur from all over the place. So, whilst one might, and the way telco and ISP operates its networks, it's not kind of one link from the peering point all the way to the end user. There are many intermediate network components across the end-to-end solution, and how one manages the capacity in each of those phases, may operate at different times and different investment cycles with different internal drivers within that particular ISP. So one of the attractions for the ecosystem of deploying content delivery structure deeper in a network, and certainly the way we've done it inside BT's wholesale's broadband infrastructure, is it's intrinsically tied with all our capacity management. So, that there isn't the possibility of delivering content to the CDN infrastructure and finding, inappropriate levels of congestion downstream, because the network and the delivery infrastructure are all tied together. It's all part of the same planning infrastructure. So there are a number of kind of interesting reasons why we decided to do that. I think the internal use case, just kind of talk about that a little, I think what's also interesting is that 5 or 6 years ago, most IPTV platforms around the world, were very, very heavily siloed. So there was no concept of a CDN as a service. The content delivery elements were vertically integrated and vertically tied to the whole service delivery stack. In a hybrid environment where there were going to be, BT Retail's own services combined with a whole load of services coming from over-the-top providers, what BT Retail wanted to see was a services-based architecture that could be called to support all those different services and all their different guises. In other words, something much, much more flexible. And that's kind of what we've delivered and is running very successfully right now on the Cisco architecture. It's been an interesting couple of years, but some good outcomes.
Thank you. Thank you. As a content provider, we see more and more demand over the next, let's say, 5 to 8 years for bandwidth. So I think 2011 will be the first year where the combined tablet and smartphone volume being sold is the first time to be more than actually the PC volume. So we are talking 350, 360 million units a year, which means actually that about 2020, we are talking about 100 billion connected devices. Even if it's only half of that, that actually is a big challenge, not just for first and second layer networks, but as well for the whole content providers on top of that one. What do you think is the best way to react on that, not just increasing demand, which, you know, skyrocketing demand for bandwidth for CDNs and for telcos?
Well, I guess, you know, my position is as I articulated earlier on in my own presentation, I don't think there's one single answer to that question. That is the challenge. That's the one, right? That's the one that keeps us all awake at night. And I think that basically, for us to be, as an industry, to be able to scale with the demand that we know, absolutely know unavoidably is coming down the line in that type of time frame, the only way we get there is with an integrated approach across the industry that involves CDNs, as Simon says, involves operators with a significant role in the delivery of content, involves large content owners with a significant role in the delivery of content, and that basically with a multiplicity of approaches that might include an operator having to stretch to deploying multiple people's infrastructure within their own infrastructure as well as their own infrastructure. That's the kind of way that operators will... ultimately, they're at the sharp end of the wedge on this, insofar as that's the connection between the consumer and the content. That's the final connection. That's the final piece in the puzzle. And I think that access providers are going to need to adopt a multiplicity of approaches to address their end of the challenge.
Yeah, from a technology point of view, what I could add is that effectively, I mean, there is a major issue if you talk to any mobile operator. And here the issue is not too much on the packet core, but more on the radio access, where content caching, you know, as the classical what we mean by CDNs, will not really help. But there are a number of technologies to optimize the video on the radio, either optimize on the 3G or eventually to offload on the Wi-Fi network, that we're working with service providers to see effectively what sort of services they could propose to media and content providers in order to deliver a good response. Because they also know the kind of device that people are using, so they are in a very good position to provide some better services for distribution on mobile. But it is really, I think, you know, early days where people start to understand this is a big issue. It wasn't an issue in the past on the mobile video, but that was my reflection with the iPhone. Clearly, that created now an urgency.
Yeah, I think the mobile angle is a really interesting way to look at this. I mean, I think fundamentally the answer to your question is that this is a really good thing. This adds an enormous amount of value to consumers, who are the ultimate people paying for all these services. So, you know, we as a business in BT, you know, want to make broadband more valuable, a more valuable commodity, across the value chain. So helping deliver something that the customers of the service really, really value feels like a very, very good thing. I think the mobile case study is really quite interesting. As Mark says, it's been seen as a major, major issue, and a number of mobile operators across Europe, you know, we've seen doing a lot of work trying to understand how they can offload this traffic, you know, onto Wi-Fi networks or other fixed networks environment, which kind of is an odd thing to do. You can see it as a, you know, see the accountants in those businesses just trying to offload the cost, but to a large extent, that approach ignores actually the concept of the value. And I think increasingly we're seeing sort of more innovative mobile operators beginning to understand that actually maintaining control of the whole end user experience and the customer value that derives from that is actually a more important part of this. So I think, you know, I think the answer is that we're creating value here. I think the challenge going forward is how we make sure that the economics of doing that kind of remain sustainable for all parties in the ecosystem.
Thank you very much. Just to make sure we stay in time, I just want to wrap it up. Thank you very much to my panelists. Thank you to the audience.
Indeed. Actually, before you guys go, just a last quick question. I was thinking about, otherwise we'll be 2 minutes early, and I attribute that to German efficiency. with 100 million devices, anyway, it's a big number. It's kind of academic. It's implicit that IPv6 will have come through by that stage, and I think IPv6 has an inherent range of features and facilities in it which will improve content distribution. So just to fill up the 2 minutes before we bring the application trend session on, do you see IPv6 making it through the access networks anytime soon? And do you think that'll make a difference? I mean, will the demand for content, for class of service, for multicast, these features that in IPv6 reaching the edge, do you think that's going to happen, or are we just going to end up running out of IP addresses and it's all going to grind to a halt?
So it's slightly outside my day-to-day domain, but my understanding is that, you know, the appropriate wheels are turning to make sure that IPv6 is supported in the network, and therefore I think the sort of running out of IP address issue is not so much the issue. Whether all of the features and services that are promised by IPv6 will be implemented in a timely manner is a slightly different issue, and I'm not close enough to it to know the answer to that.
Yeah, I could just mention that, I mean, it's been a long time we've been talking about IPv6 for the people in the industry, but yeah, I think we start to see the move. It still has an implication for operators. I mean, obviously you don't move from IPv4 to an IPv6, but just as an illustration, we have an operator in France called Free Iliad, and they recently migrated to IPv6, and now they are a pure IPv6. I think they're one of the few that started. I mean, the small ones, obviously, it's big, faster than a BT or an Orange to move, but those are a couple of proofs that show that, yeah, the technology start to be mature, and the cost to migrate start to be more possible.
I'm an optimist, Dom. I think that rather like the Eurozone crisis, it might take a lot longer than you actually want or than it should, but eventually people get there, and you know, you do the right thing in the end. So I think that IPv6 is more an inevitability than obviously if it's not, we run out of IPv4 addresses, and then that's the end of that. So. I think we get to IPv6. I think, as Simon says, what that actually looks like, that doesn't inherently imply that like multicast is enabled across the access networks. Does that happen? You know, I don't know. I think it's hard to see. There's been a compelling logic to multicast for a long time, to take that as an example, and it hasn't happened yet. So maybe not.
Okay, guys, well, listen, once again, it's a round of applause to the panel and for Andreas. Thank you very much. And while we play musical chairs, I'm just going to ask if we could switch the panel session around, if the application trends guys would like to come up, and Tim, I'd like to bring Tim up to stage. So what does the audience think? Do you guys think IPv6 is going to happen anytime soon? Are we talking 2 years? Hands for 2 years. Access networks.
Depends where you're talking.
Well, I'm talking right through to the access devices, to the end users. Let's start here in the UK.
10 years.
What do you think? 10 years? But let's throw this out. If the iPhone starts to support IPv6, so iPhone 5 comes out, that's the sort of churn which could really kick off. In my mind, could really kick off the change. So it's obviously a very engaging topic.
Yeah.
Are you going to support IPv6 from the booth?
Should be all right to just close the lid.
Okay. We need to actually go ahead and switch to the next slide.
We can just close this.
I don't know, they mean I want to the two of us just side by side, huh?
So the base was.
Was it was good. I see it.
Did you get in
today? No, oh, yeah. No, I'm good. I'm good.
Hi, Steve. Steve.
Hi, Olivier.
How are you doing?
Hi. Oh, no, because a couple of years I was not working at the motion. I might have met at IWC, but with another cap.
Fantastic. My name's Aaron. Didn't actually talk about that. Oh, Eric, are you here? Are you back from the police?
Yeah, I came back.
I'll find you one. There is a new Wi-Fi code, guys. All of you who've got been sitting there going, I can't get my email.
Duke, can I just say it's HH9904.
Oh, okay, hold on.
It's almost
okay.
Like a lottery ticket. HH9904.
Right. I know, it's like stuck in my head. When you can get Wi-Fi for free, you're like, that number.
I never forget it.
So, next part of the session, we haven't got quite a full boxing ring this year. Microsoft didn't turn up. But we have the application trends session. And we instigated this to get an opportunity to look at the people who are really the beating heart of the technology in the industry, in the video services industry, all the server vendors. And so I'm going to hand over to Tim Siglin, who is one of the most prolific writers on streaming radio. Although we've been missing your writing for the last month, Tim. Stop traveling.
Yeah, I was going to say, having electricity consistently in Nigeria would have been a helpful thing. So
I'm going to hand over to Tim Siglin.
Great, thank you very much. As Don mentioned, I'm Tim Siglin. I'm a contributing editor with Streaming Media, also have a consulting firm, and I described my 2 days here as being a nice Christmas break between two hard semesters, because the last week I was in Nigeria in places where I was lucky to have electricity for 1.5 hours a day, and then I leave on Wednesday to go to Ghana to work in a similar area. So I'm using as much Wi-Fi as I possibly can over the course of the next 2 days to up my consumption level to an average for the month. I'd like each of the panelists to go ahead and just introduce themselves briefly, name and title.
Sure. Charlie Good, one of the founders and CTO of Wowza Media Systems.
I'm Steve Allison. I'm a technical evangelist for the Adobe Systems.
I'm Olivier Quero. I'm sales director at FluMotion. We used to be a server provider, but I would define now our company as more on the online video platform sector. So,
okay,
changing a little bit, adapting
to the environment,
to the market.
Okay.
Hi there, Arjen Wagner. I'm from CodeShop, based in the Netherlands.
And Dave Mallinson from Rho Networks, technical sales.
Great, thank you.
Cool. Yeah.
So I've given the panelists three questions, and we're going to kind of work off that and then open it up for questions and answers, as the last panel did. One of the questions that I asked was, if you kind of look at two sides of the coins, there are the features that the CDNs come and ask the server platform companies for. There are the potential features that the server platform companies try to go sell into the CDNs. So looking at that second part first, what features does your company offer in a current release of the software that you feel like are underutilized features for the content delivery network providers? And I'll open that up. Actually, go ahead and we'll start on the far end.
So
these are things you wish they would use because they would solve a problem.
Well, Rho Networks has only just released this feature, so it's a bit of a new one, so people might not know about it. But in the latest release of the software, we have a multi-track feature that allows CDNs and content providers to create their content in a format that reduces their complexity from an encoding level, where you can actually create video in a single format and have multiple audio tracks and then have it truly synchronized out to multiple different devices for delivery to the end users. So that way you can actually make sure that the content that's being played out can have French language with a video track, English language with the same video track, and saves your storage costs on a CDN network. So it's not really a feature the CDNs may want to promote because it's reducing the storage costs. So they don't make quite as much. But from an end user, they will see it as a big benefit to them, because you can actually start offering more content feeds, more distribution of the content to different users using different audio tracks or even video tracks. So that's one of the features that Real Networks has recently released. As I say, it's not something probably anyone in this room's probably even heard of. Alongside that, we have the multi-device capability that I'm sure everyone here is very focused on, and CDNs are specifically focused on trying to get their content out to end users on whatever devices. We heard 100 billion devices out there these days IP connected. You want to make sure that you can get it the best way possible.
So let me ask a quick question on the multi-track. Beyond the typical web DVD scenario that we all think about, replicating that, what other types of application trends would you see that being used for, use cases that somebody would use that for?
So we've already had a number of customers talk to us about delivering DVD type experiences on the web, having the ability to have live conferences like this where you have an audio translation on the fly happening, and people can tune into whatever audio channel they want live with the same video track. So you're seeing the same video as everyone else. But in other scenarios, to actually do that in multiple languages requires a lot of hardware, a lot more bandwidth, especially if you're in a remote location. So taking the video from here and uplinking it to a CDN for doing delivery, if you had to do that in five languages with five video tracks and five audio tracks, that's a lot of bandwidth. Whereas if you do it once video and multiple audio tracks, you can save the bandwidth capacity and get into the CDN for doing the distribution to the end users.
Okay, great. Arjen?
Well, I think that mainly you will see, I think what you'll see is a shift from the functionality that's now currently available in the at the origin servers, but it actually makes a shift towards more for the CDNs towards the edge nodes, and the actual the packaging, for example, with the multiple audio tracks and the different video tracks, different bit rates, and especially for the different playout formats, the actual packaging will take place at the edge nodes. Because that will actually solve quite a bit, or at least it's one step towards solving the storage requirements, because you only have to store it once instead of having all the different formats available. So that's one, I think that's probably the first step that we'll see, that there will be that will be the first step of the functionality that will move from the origin server to the edge nodes, and that's probably what you'll the first thing you'll see, that's it's easiest to implement on the edges.
And you see that implementation within currently within current products, or 6 months out?
6 months out.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Very good. Go ahead.
Nothing particular to add for that.
So at Adobe, we've changed our architecture for Flash Media Server. As we see more people using HTTP, we've gone more towards the just-in-time delivery of HTTP assets. So again, that's going to make the edge caching far easier, because once we've created those fragments from FMS, bringing in the concept of the origin cache, which again, probably for CDNs, isn't going to have that big of an impact, but for the users, will have a much greater impact, because you're going to be able then to have the CDNs pull from an origin cache off the Flash Media Server and then just deliver it out, rather than sort of uploading to the CDNs, having them do your fragmentation, protection, or whatever. Bringing that back, if you like, behind the origin cache makes that a lot easier. So the CDN's ability to be able to roll that out and move caches around should make video delivery a lot more scalable using the Flash platform.
So what's the compelling argument for the CDN? I mean, obviously you said for the end user there's a benefit. Where's the benefit for the CDN in terms of not losing revenue per se?
So it's in their ability to move things around, to be honest. I mean, there aren't many customers who are going to have an infrastructure big enough to reach the entire audience that they have. So the CDNs are still going to remain a vital part of that distribution network. But with once you start using HTTP and you have fragments out there throughout the CDN caches, there are various things that you can then do to recreate those caches in different orders. So recreate fragments in different orders, bring together new content from those fragments you've already delivered. That's a job, if you like, that the CDNs can do. But by having the customer able to recreate those files from it, should make, again, a nice balance between the needs of both organizations.
Okay. Charlie?
So I think it's kind of cool. WiLE's of both services, the CDN markets as well as the individual content owners that run our software, you know, on their own. And so it's the individual software owners that tend to drive our features, so drive a lot of the innovative features, asking us to do kind of new cool things with video, new cool things with time, data, events, just new cool things across the board. And then generally they want to scale that, and so they take that to the CDN, and they ask the CDN to implement those type of features. So it's really good to us, because we listen to our individual content owners that run our software on its own. They go push the CDNs to implement our features in their content delivery networks, just so that they can scale their solution. So in a lot of ways, you know, we see our features show up at the kind of cooler features in our products we see show up at CDNs based on our customers' needs, because they're running the software, you know, initially individually. The one feature in particular we just added to our software in the version that just came out 2 weeks ago is a much easier way to do multi-bit rate streaming, adaptive streaming, is to do the transcoding in the server, like right next to the streaming server. And so we've enabled accelerated transcoding such that you can send a high bitrate stream into WoW as a server. We'll do the multi-bitrate renditions on the fly, and then you can deliver it out over the CDN right there. And so now the individual content owner that has that live feed that they want to distribute across a large CDN, they can send a single live feed in instead of having to manage multiple that are properly keyframe aligned. And so we think that's a big feature that the CDN should pick up on, because it's a premium service that they'll be able to charge for and make a lot of money off of.
And do I understand from Alex, and I may have this wrong, but when I talked to either Alex or Dave at IBC, they said that transcode manager itself is actually driving the sale of kind of the server product, because it's considered a plug-in?
Yeah, that's how we see it. It kind of ends up working backwards. I mean, that's not how it is today, right? Mm-hmm. This is a new feature that's just coming out.
Okay.
But we actually do see that being a driving feature to getting our software in more content delivery networks.
Okay, very good. So let's switch it around then. Say, what are some of the application trends that the CDNs are seeing that they're coming to your companies and saying, hey, this is something we want, this is something that we see a need for? Understanding that this is not necessarily what's in your current release, but things as you're looking forward and trying to address. And we'll start at your end, Charlie, and move back the other way.
So the thing we get
pushed
for...
And, of course, I'm asking you to reveal secrets
to your competitors. No, I know. That's fine, though. So the thing that we get pushed on is what he just said, and we don't do, is that we are not a caching origin, and we've never been set up well as a caching origin. And it's something that we need to do, and it's something that you'll see from us in the near future. And so now that we're going to enable the ability to do multi-bitrate live streaming in a simple way, the next thing for us is to enable you to do that in a very efficient way using kind of straight HTTP caching. And so that's kind of the next move for us. That's the feature that we're asked about all the time, and that's something that's certainly coming.
And will that be a plug-in or part of the core server?
Most likely a plug-in.
Okay. So you really are moving forward with this plug-in model where you have different plugins to the core server.
Yeah, I mean, it's a trade. When we look at a feature, we decide how we want to package it. Right? We don't want to become this single monolithic huge application that you have to kind of bite off a huge bite to kind of install and deal with. If we can kind of segment off features that are only interesting to certain people, then we're going to do that and package those as add-ons
and charge accordingly
server.
For those. Yeah. Okay. All right.
It's not about price gouging. It's really about packaging.
Okay. Just curious. All right.
Maybe I'm going to talk about. So it's I'm here, but it's a little bit uncomfortable because we are a CDN. We used to sell to CDN, and we're also selling to broadcasters and corporate markets. So what we've seen in that we just launched in May this year a service that's called Live Transcoding, and I think it's a bit like Alex. Has been explained.
Sure.
So typically we've seen that there has been a lot of demand from the CDN operator. We launched this service, in fact, to address the broadcasters and the corporate that has the problematic of encoding their live feed and transcoding their live feed to all these multiple devices. And we've received much more demand from the CDN themselves that wanted to add this functionality to their services than towards the broadcaster. So we've received some demand from the broadcasters, but a lot of the major CDN. In fact, we've worked first with Edgecast, so we launched this service with in partnership with Edgecast. Edgecast came to us and really wanted to have this feature in their service portfolio to address the complexity of live transcoding. And after that, we've been in discussion with all the major CDNs, or at least well, level three was missing. I was talking with Derek before, say if we can engage together. But we've been talking to Akamai, Lamlight, Tata, and all the major CDN that have been really have received this new services as a very interesting service. Then we, as a CDN provider, so we are seeing that the demand is coming from trying to moving the intelligence from the player side to the server side. I guess this is coming from the complexity also that we are having on the service development level, where we have a lot of fragmentation in the player side.
No pun intended.
Sorry,
no pun intended, fragmentation on the player side.
So we are typically what we've just released also in our service offering, because we're more software service company, is the ability to inject advertising in stream and again this is to try to avoid the complexity of building those monetization models with all this fragmentation of players. We've been talking a lot of HTML5 in the recent months, and typically HTML5 today, one of the biggest issue in HTML5 is the monetization today. So so we've done it right now for audio for the moment. So we are now working on how to implement this in-stream ad injection into the video content. But on the audio side, we've been already successful in Spain with three customers. We are also in partnership with an ad server that's called AdSuite, that is also quite specialized in the audio market. So these are the two things I would say: on one side the live transcoding, and on the other side the in-stream ad injection.
So a question: you mentioned with the live transcoding, you're getting more traction with CDNs than broadcasters. Why do you think that?
It's not that we're getting more traction on the CDN. We're also getting traction for typical companies that are doing a lot of webcast, live content. But we were surprised to receive also such demand from the CDN. So that's why I'm mentioning it. It's not that we're receiving more, but we were quite surprised that, in fact, the more pushy at the very beginning has been the CDN. And in fact, because we were competing against them at our scale, for sure, not on a global scale, but we were competing with them, and we saw with that new service, we saw that there was also an opportunity to potentially now partner with the CDN themselves. And in fact, this is where we're also going now. We're trying to go more, as we position more on the value-added service side of the content distribution. Our goal now is typically to find new partnership areas with those CDN that are definitely also looking for value-added services. As Derek was saying, there is a huge commoditization in the CDN market. So at the end, it will be about competing based on service and value-added services more than how I deliver the bytes.
Okay. All right, very good. Steve, from an Adobe standpoint.
Yeah, so we're doing a lot of work with the CDNs on a couple of fronts. First is just management of delivery. So we have a concept in Flash of the DVR window, or rewind windows on live events, that kind of stuff. We spend a lot of time working with the CDNs, helping to automate that process. You can have rolling windows and cleaning up behind yourself, and the general housekeeping, if you like, of delivery, which is amazingly important when you're trying to get an efficient system running. The other thing is enabling them to package up parts of our technology for their delivery stack, for building into their own solutions. So the just-in-time fragmentation, the DRM technologies that we have, enabling them to be able to offer those as services on their own rights.
And does that have any applicability to what was talked about at Max with Air 3, where you can take a portion of air and actually put it into an application itself so that there's no problem with incompatibility of different versions?
It should make it a lot easier for people who distribute the video to ensure that their player and will be absolutely compatible with the technology that's actually delivering it to. So we call that binding in the runtime into the AIR application, which basically means everything that you need is wrapped up in that application, as you install it on iOS or Android or whatever it might be. So it should make it a much, much better experience for people.
And to explain that a little more to the audience, I did some testing earlier this year looking at video performance and battery impact on Android devices, and I'm going to be doing a session tomorrow talking about some of the findings. But what I found was very interesting was, as I would go through different builds of AIR, a video player that would work beautifully in one version of AIR, when I was forced to do an update to AIR for all my applications, it would break some of the applications. No fault of Adobe's to a certain extent. Obviously, there are tweaks and things that are changed. But I had to then go back to the developers to get them to make changes to their players or their gaming systems, as I was testing gaming as well. And this particular capability says, okay, fine, the application itself that you download is going to be bigger because it's going to have the runtime integrated into it. But the thinking is that it's better to actually have a bigger application that you only download that and don't have to also download AIR. So that you guarantee that your delivery will be consistent against the version of AIR that you developed in. Arjen?
Yeah, what we see is it's instead of live, it's actually for for larger VOD archives. It's like when a customer has a very large VOD, say thousands of hours of video, and that's currently available in one in just one format because they chose either HLS or perhaps HTTP dynamic streaming, is that we support more different input formats. So we can, next to MPEG-4, we can also read HLS and Apple's MPEG-4, Adobe's MPEG-4 format, and then make that available in all the different playout formats again, which makes it for a CDN, if you already have an existing VOD archive, then you can just update the software and say it's like, well, can I also make it available in these two or three more existing formats?
And do you find that that's a compelling thing, that the CDNs are driving you to do?
Yes, because it will save for these larger archives. People don't really want to go through the whole remuxing or the retranscoding, buying additional storage. You talk about huge storage space. So if you want to play out to a different format, that would actually mean doubling your storage. And if you go to three formats, that would triple your storage. And then perhaps DRM will be applied to different levels. So storage just explodes. So anything you can support all the way at the front to support, so that you can also read that and then play out in different formats, it saves on storage investments. Instead of weeks of transcoding and transmuxing, it's solved at the web server at the end.
And even the caching layer as well, right? If you can
right.
push all that work out to the edge, right? So you're just caching that source material, the kind of single truth out to the edge, and then the actual rewrapping and breaking up into segment and fragmenting is done as close to the edge as possible. And again, that's something our software does as well. And it's a very important piece kind of to the puzzle, because I mean, you start to do the math around an hour video delivered in four different player technologies and six different bit rates, broken up into 10-second fragments, and the numbers are huge, and that's just one video, right? It's kind of crazy.
So, but I guess my question is, you push it out further to the edge to do that rewrappering and like that, the sheer amount of processing that you're using, obviously it's distributed processing, but you're raising the amount of processing significantly.
It isn't that big of a deal.
We're
able to. I mean, using our stuff as a benchmark. I mean, we're able to kind of rewrap very, very quickly. Yeah, and the file formats, the MP4 file format makes it fairly simple to dig in and grab a chunk and just push it back out in whatever format.
What about pushing it over to converting it over to HLS?
That is a little more difficult because you have to take it to TS, transport stream, but still, again, we're able to do that pretty efficiently. And the processors are getting just faster and faster and faster, so there is a lot more compute power on the edge.
Okay. Yeah, I guess I'm trying to, and if you say it's not that big of a deal, I'm kind of just trying to go through the arc in terms of the power consumption that we'd be dealing with, you know, as we raise that with multiple edge devices. But again, you know, efficiencies perhaps will take care of that.
Depends how you want to do it, though, because I mean, if, if you rewrapping into MPEG-2TS is let's say fairly simple. It doesn't take that much computing power. But once you've got the HTTP and you've got your caches, surely it's easier to replicate your caches across the edges as well, rather than having to do it. Because once your machine has crunched and done the fragmentation, it doesn't do that every time a user calls it. It goes into cache, and we can do things with the cache there.
Mm-hmm. Okay, fair point. David?
Yeah, I was going to say the same thing about being able to repacketize content for delivery either at the edge or further upstream in the network, depending on how you want to have your network architected. Something that Real Networks gets asked a lot about, how flexible is the technology to be able to make the decisions based on how you specifically want to have it deployed. You don't have to have it at the edge, you don't have to have it in the core, you can have it a mix and match, you can have it for all the different formats, for flash, for HLS, dynamic adaptive streaming coming soon. So you need to have those type of, that's one of the requirements that we always get heard from, we hear from CDNs. One of the other areas that Real spent a lot of time doing is around actually helping customers who have got content that's in, say, HLS format for Apple, and being able to play that out onto an onto an Android device. So Real has technology that we can actually help application developers, be it if you're providing an application service as a CDN, or whether you're just offering a core network delivery, you can take the HLS code for Android that Real has, embed it in your application that an end user plays back, and you're playing back your HLS content that would be out to your Apple phones, but also playing it out to your Android phones. So that then saves some of the processing power because you're using the same chunks twice, rather than using RTSP out to some of the Android phones that are out there today.
Okay, good. And then one last question before we open for the audience. speaking about applications, say, on mobile handset devices and tablets, what kind of trends do you see there in terms of applications becoming more robust, players that will handle multiple formats, the ability to do HLS as well as FragMP4? What are some of the trends that you see in the applications themselves?
So kind of going back to what I just said, the application developers now have a lot of different types of technologies that they can use within their applications that end users are using. All you have to do, though, is think about what the end user wants to experience. Once you think about the end user, what they want to experience, how they want to experience it, then everything else should fall into place. The most optimal delivery mechanism, the way to actually get the content onto the device in the format that the application supports for playout. You are seeing people take the application code, a bit like Adobe was saying, kind of more higher level, so that your app is slightly larger because it actually has code in it itself, rather than using the underlying technology that's on devices, purely because you then don't have to worry about different devices having different versions of the underlying Android operating system or Apple operating system or other operating systems themselves, or the core flash code, or trying to take that away from the complexity and including it in the app does make sense because it's a one-time feed down. And if you think about what users are going to be doing with these apps, viewing video, video is going to use a lot more bandwidth than a one-time install of an application.
Fair point.
Yeah, I think you'll see a lot of functionality move into available SDK or player SDKs, because then currently we have like a couple of playout formats, but then of course we also have a variety of DRM formats and ultraviolet arriving sometime soon, and as well as like support varies between the different players for multiple languages. iOS 5 just, well, there is some support for multiple languages in there. Smooth streaming already supports it quite well. Subtitling captions, it's hardly available, and if it's available, it's a completely different standard for the different players and the different playout formats. So I think a lot of these things will be, if somebody can make a decent SDK for players available, which supports most of these things, then I think you'll make a lot of application developers quite happy.
So let me ask, though, I mean, part of the issues you just described there, MPEG-Dash is supposed to address. that's not necessarily at an SDK level. That's at a standards level. Where do you see the difference between what you're describing and kind of what the MPEG Dash committees are working on?
That's basically the playout formats that they're standardized.
As well as the encryption formats, the common file format models.
Well, MPEG Dash will support ultraviolet, and ultraviolet is a standard by itself again with multiple DRM.
Right. Yeah. And we've got several of these standards actually pointing back to one another, which certainly could create some potential issues.
For example, for subtitling or anything like that, then there are no specifics mentioned about it. Yeah. So we still have to. They have to be sorted out some way or another.
True. Time text is mentioned, but not to the extent that you're talking about. Okay, very good.
With regard to the application, in fact, we are addressing that more on the online video platform side. So, at least being able to index, categorize your content, so you can have the flexibility after that to build application based on the different standard that are today. So in fact, it's about addressing more the management of the assets jointly with also the delivery of the assets to enable fast categorization, indexation, and reuse those contents to then broadcast them across the different applications. So in fact, we're seeing a lot of value in addressing the whole value chain, just not just the delivery itself, but more on the content management side, and to give the tools and the APIs that those SDKs or SDKs needs to develop new experience. What we're definitely seeing is that we are moving from, I would say, the traditional delivery of on-demand content or a simulcast of a live to more specific experience in the online. I think we've not reached this phase yet in terms of application. Today, we're most of the companies and people are just simulcasting what they are doing on air or whatsoever. We definitely see that there is also a trend now to build specific applications or programming for the online, not only replicating what have been done on air or whatsoever. It's now so it's to have the ability to also to play with live and on-demand content to really build a pure online experience. That I think it's going to be the trend in the next months or year. It's really to address the online not as an extension of the on-air typically, but the online as also creating an online experience with all that is offered to us right now, with all these SDKs and all the Flash creative suites and so on, interactivity, social media. We believe there are still a lot of things to be done in the online that is specific content for the online than it is done today. Yeah.
So one quick clarification on the notes that I was taking as you were talking. You're effectively saying, you're building a platform on which obviously the APIs are extensible from your platform. How does FluMotion, though, as an OVP, guarantee that their platform functions consistently across multiple types of devices?
First of all, when we talk about APIs, we're talking about completely standard REST APIs.
Okay.
So it's any web developers are using those API. Then what we're integrating the whole process of encoding, transcoding, and formatting all those content into our platform. So the user doesn't have to. It's really a package solution where both transcoding and content management are completely integrated. So there is no headache of knowing what kind of profile I need and what kind of resolution I need, what kind of codec I need, and our transcoding software is software based. So by definition, also we can definitely add new codecs as they are coming. That FluMotion was one of the first company in the world to do a WebM live streaming. So this is also the flexibility of adding new codecs as they are coming to the market. So we're kind of integrating the whole process, the flow of ingesting, transcoding, and publishing the content, and then exposing it through a simple REST API.
Sure, and let me maybe ask it slightly more simply. Does the onus fall on FluMotion as the platform to go test the 100 Android devices that each have a variation of the Android operating system that's slightly different in implementation on each device?
Well, I mean, at the end, we're doing a trade-off of the variety of format or resolution that we can have, and because when we talk about format, also we tend to think about it from a technology standpoint, and at the end, the people that are operating our platform on a daily basis are, they are content managers. So don't ask him to talk about what is the most optimum format or resolution for that kind of version of the Android. So we're trying to simplify it to the more common formats,
okay,
and reach the best user experience at the end.
And I asked that specifically because one of the things I found in my testing was I couldn't guarantee RTSP would actually deliver consistently to Android devices. Some of them it worked beautifully, some of them it didn't work at all.
Yeah.
So if you say we'll just go with RTSP,
but in fact we've I'm sorry, but we've kind of we're not using RTSP at all.
Okay.
From our historically, FluMotion streaming server that is based on GStreamer was an HTTP server, so we're using HTTP delivery for doing that.
Great. Steve, Adobe's standpoint?
So we definitely see on devices more people interested in apps rather than browser-based stuff. And frankly, that pays right into the strengths of Flash and there. Your comment about consistency and same experience, that kind of stuff, that's why people have historically used Flash. We've got closed captions, we've got time text XML, we've got DRM, we've got a workflow that is the same wherever the Flash player exists. So not quite the same, so you have different screen sizes and everything else, but essentially most of that workflow remains fairly consistent, and therefore your code base remains fairly consistent through all those different devices. So actually, Flash is a strength when you're actually delivering the same kind of application to multiple devices.
Although at Max I heard, HTML is just as good. But anyway, Charlie?
And I think what we're trying to do is take what he just said and move that beyond just Flash. So we're supporting all those same
technologies. Sorry, I didn't mean to cue that up for you.
You did. I had to take it. And so we're trying to do time, text, and data events, richer events, within the Apple HLS protocol. Same thing with smooth streaming. We're really trying to normalize that across, all the different devices and player technologies. So if you want to create kind of a rich experience, but you also want it to be, done correctly with the right player, with the native player on each of the different devices, whether it's iPhone, a Windows phone, or a tablet of some nature, then that's what we're trying to do. We're trying to enable that in our platform.
Okay, great. All right, we've got 10 minutes left. Let's open it up for Q&A. And Dom, are you going to be the lovely assistant, or would you like me to do my own? All right, questions from the audience.
It's not really a question, I just wanted to add a few things. As a content provider, we see two major trends in applications. From a CDN point of view, it's everything that adds value. Because currently, content providers are seeing, it's good for us, but it's bad for CDNs, that big content providers pay something like $10 to $20 per terabyte. And that isn't sustainable for all CDNs in the long run. So everything that drives value is most of the trends we see that goes from on-the-fly transcoding of live streams up to dynamic application transcoding of images for mobile devices and everything you literally can think of, which is good because it actually adds value for them and hopefully drives more business towards not anymore being compatible with just moving bytes from left to right or the other way around. The other thing is, from an application point of view, actually the big trend we see is making it easier for medium-sized businesses to move their content, to devices. It doesn't really matter if it's a PC, if it's a mobile, and everything around that one. And we currently see that more offerings are available for HTML-based or actually HTML5-based offerings because they are more dynamically changeable at the CDN edge. For example, real-time transcoding of images to real estate sizes, for example. And where we see currently less offerings, especially in the framework sides, for example, Flash. We haven't seen any provider right now who could do a kind of on-the-fly transcoding of Flash applications to fit on devices. And that's pretty much one of those questions. Is there something where it's likely to see so that we can see, okay, if I'm having a Flash application for a Android-based device, that on the edge side, a CDN could detect, oh, that one is a smaller size device, and that's the reason why on the fly I'm changing content, delivering to the application without actually changing the application.
So that's, okay.
I'll go first. Okay. So, historically, you're absolutely correct. From Adobe's point of view, there are two things we're trying to do to make that multi-device translation a lot smoother. First of those is being able to identify what kind of Flash player you are. Okay, so we're making it a lot easier for any kind of server technology to understand the kind of Flash player that it's talking to. Because that has material effect on what you do. I mean, are you a television Flash player or are you a mobile phone? Vast difference between the two. So by making that easier, it makes it easier for people to tie in resizing stuff. That's not our job. We don't do that technology. Our job is to make it easier to integrate with those technologies. The second thing is we're making the Flash runtime much more intelligent. So we have, for example, something called the OSMF, our video player framework technology. That is now starting to have the ability to understand the kind of device it's being played on. So when it gets, if you play on an Android device that's a low-end model, it will render everything in software, you know, as Flash has always done. If it's a slightly better model of Android device, it will automatically hand over to the hardware. So it will understand the kind of tin that it's on, what it's trying to render, and therefore either use software or hardware as applicable. And that also then rolls into things like the UI. Am I a big screen? Great, I will have knobs and whistles and everything around the video screen. Am I a small screen? No, just push out video. So we're trying to make our applications and our runtime able to adapt to the content and also make it easier for other systems to understand, you know, where does Flash fit into this. The other thing is, you know, we do a heck of a lot of stuff on HTML5. You know, we are fully behind that. You know, it's not there yet. It cannot compete against Flash today, this year. It will do, and hopefully we're going to be part of that revolution. So it's really about what's the best way of doing that and handling that. We're seeing a lot of people building HTML5 UIs and sticking Flash Player as an actual renderer of it because they need the DRM, they need the multiple bit rates, and that kind of stuff. So, you know, we're trying to make it a lot easier to build that kind of flexibility in.
So a quick question on that. You talk about the fact that you're looking, the first part you talked about was knowing what version of Flash Player a particular device has. Do you not then run the risk of having so many versions of Flash Player that it provides an inconsistent experience?
That shouldn't happen.
Okay.
Okay.
You heard it here, folks.
I heard it here.
That shouldn't happen.
Okay. No. So we have changed our release pattern for the Flash Player. So you may have noticed there have been far more Flash Players sort of come out. So we do a major release, but in the middle there are several sort of minor updates. Those all have from the start, a consistent level of compatibility. So most of the mobile systems at the moment are going to be around the 10.3 level of the Flash Player. Flash Player 11 is out, which is the current one. But you can identify what the Flash Player is when you're actually talking to it. And Flash will also, you know, understand content that it can't understand. So it'll understand, you know, whether it needs a new version or whatever else. So if you have a system which is delivering a kind of content to a kind of Flash Player, it's entirely something that you will know and understand when you actually talk to that device. So there shouldn't be a case where you're talking to a Flash player and you don't know its capabilities.
So let me see if I understand, though. Let's say, for instance, because, like you said, the mobile tends to trend a bit behind the desktop release. Within the build, would it say specifically, I'm Flash Player 11.0.1 build such and such, and that build is what identifies it as being a set-top box Flash Player?
Right. So okay. There's essentially a string that identifies it as a type of Flash Player.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So even if they have the same dot release, effectively each one of them can be identified.
Unique. Correct. Okay. There are slight variations we make in the Flash Player in terms of how it talks to the underlying tin. Okay. So whilst we maintain the flash capabilities, exactly how it executes those on the tin depends upon whether the tin can actually manage that kind of stuff. So that's where the subtle variations at the end of that line of numbers comes into play.
Okay.
But we're also changing the flash player so that the desktop release should coincide now with the mobile releases to try and keep everything in step.
Okay, very good. Any of the other panelists want to add anything from Aaron's, from Andreas's?
Well, I just left. I think the answer is to let one of these guys win, right? Is it Apple that's going to win? Is it Adobe? Is it Microsoft?
Is there any framework in the near future being closer woven together with the CDN? Because getting more ability to figure out which device I'm working on is the first step. The second step is to tell the CDN, without talking back to the original, that I need a transcoded version of a stream, a picture, a real estate transformation, or whatsoever. And that kind of part, as far as I'm aware, isn't on anybody's roadmap, really, to make the framework talking more closely to a CDN without an interaction to the original.
So one of the panelists mentioned more intelligence out to the player and the edge. Is there the possibility that the players themselves, the applications themselves, could be tied more closely to the CDN as opposed to necessarily the framework?
So I'm not sure that's a useful thing to do particularly, because a lot of, depending on your video delivery needs, obviously. So broadcast, that kind of stuff, require, and we heard in the panel earlier, an independence from the CDN so they can have multiple CDNs.
I understand multiple CDNs. I guess I'm looking at it more from like the DEC standpoint, where you've got multiple encryption schemes and you only need one of those encryption schemes. Could the player itself say, if it's Akamai, here's what I need. If it's Limelight, here's what I need, et cetera. Or is that just, overkill?
We would tend to think that it's a fragment. It doesn't matter where it comes from, particularly. The fragment is going to be the same. The naming convention, the calling convention remains the same and consistent, whatever CDN is delivering it, whatever server is delivering it. And therefore, if your player understands its playlist, that should get you the performance you need.
Yeah, but I think what Andreas is saying is I need a transcode service to kick in at a particular point.
Yeah,
as opposed to I need a fragment.
And even beyond just video, right? It's
yeah.
not it's not
yeah.
just the video assets, it's the other images and the other assets.
From a content provider point of view, it starts getting overkill. And if you just have a look at pictures, the number of dimensions, sizes, bit rates, not even talking about language, which is great, but all the other stuff, it's multiplicating. And if I have a look at Android today, it looks nice, but actually, if I go back to my QA colleagues, they have six or seven basic devices of Android, and every Android device is acting slightly different. So actually, offloading that one to a CDN or another evaluated provider for a CDN is useful for every content provider, because it makes us, again, focusing on what we are here for, is content creation, and not anymore the overkill of device QA.
And I'll add one more thing to this, and then Dom, if you'll let me, actually, we're up against time, but I'd like to ask for one more question from the audience. Let me say this. One of the things that I found interesting at Adobe Max 2 weeks ago was Adobe bought a company called Typekit, and Typekit does web fonts, and web fonts was a huge, huge issue, but rather than Adobe trying to bake that into the platform, they actually just bought a company that provided that service and was effectively a value-added service provider. So I actually think that trend will be something that we'll also see, kind of going to the flu motion point on what the OVP does. All right, any other questions from the audience or second question?
Okay, I'm going to chip in here, Tim, because I'm going to wrap up the session as well. So two quick things. I envisage this session next year, I'm going to be fighting to keep you guys in my session. I think it's going to get pulled over to streaming media. They want to have all the server vendors, and there's loads of questions that audience want to ask you. But the question I'm about to ask, I think it fringes on maybe a streaming media question rather than necessarily a content delivery summit one. But you're talking about transmuxing, transrating, all these different functionality you can add actually in the network, which leads me to ask, from your opinions, would there be an ideal mezzanine file to be storing on your origin? So if you're going to translate from a source file, if I'm a content provider, Richard's had to go, but if I was the BBC or if I'm Andreas and I'm authoring content, do I want to keep an AVI uncompressed? Do I want to keep an MPEG-2? Do I want to keep an MP4? Do I want to keep a flash video? You guys can flip them into anything, and it probably doesn't matter what comes in because you can probably get it out, but you guys are the experts here. what is, in your mind, what would be the best format to master?
And let me add a slight variation to that. Coming out of the world of motion picture editing and working with Avids and the other systems, we have formats that we work with and we see as quality formats for our masters or mezzanines. Are those acceptable, or are they just way too big?
Well, there is actually work on this field. It's actually called the common file format, and the DRM part is called the common encryption, and that's actually the common encryption is the ultraviolet part, where multiple DRM vendors have decided on a way that they can support from that one format, you can play out to the five different DRM formats being supported. One of them is Adobe. Mm-hmm. And a common file format that's basically MPEG-4 based, and that's what pretty much everybody's been using already. Mm-hmm. So I think a very good format would be, the common file format MPEG-4 with, on top of that, a common encryption, which is ultraviolet. And that
so
would work.
Standard defining things like keyframe rate and so on, because obviously you need a certain minimum amount of keyframes to be able to create.
It has a number of profiles, and as somebody said to me as I was going through, because I'm writing a white paper around this, they threw everything in the kitchen sink in there, and then the assumption is, there's an HLS profile in there. Whether Apple will ever use that to build an MPEG-compliant player is suspect, because that particular profile is what Apple officially publishes. But if you try to use Apple's official publication for most targets that you do, you'll find that there's a secret version of it that works better.
Cool. And one last thing, right? Just keep it dragging on. What the hell about you guys in coffee? You don't care. One other thing. So on the backside of all the on-demand servers, you guys are often hooking into local file systems and so on. I've been off the practical side of building CDNs for 18 months now. But when I was last there, there wasn't anything really well built on the back end for managing the integration with SAN or with cloud storage and so on and so forth. You guys just assume that the content's going to be available on a UNC link and walk away from it. That actually used to be a bit of a nightmare for me building a CDN. And increasingly I see, this year I think the OVP's kind of reached its maximum. Now people want curated content. And more I think that actually comes right back to the organization of your storage architecture and so on. And I do see that there has traditionally been a bit of a lack of planning. If you've got one server, it can point at one UNC, but if you've got 30 servers, how are you going to manage the hook into your SAN and so on? Have you guys changed things in the last 18 months, or is there work afoot to do that?
I'd say it's gotten, the problem's so much worse now. I don't know if there's a solution, but the long tail of content is much longer. And then now there's this thing to do multi-bit rate. And so you look at that problem, it's actually exponentially grown as an issue as far as how do I store that much content and how do I access it in a reasonable manner to get it out.
It's almost like you need CDN on a micro scale between the server and the sources of content.
And we struggle with that. We have technology called Media Cache that tries to push some of that out to the edge. But, it's not industrial strength enough, folks that want to do large-scale VOD, long-tail delivery. There needs to be some innovation in that area.
Oh, there are some innovation, but like multi-layer management of databases and things like this, but not yet.
But they're generally more expensive.
Revisit this one next year. Yeah. See where we got to. Cool. Okay. Well, listen. Sorry to eat into your coffee break, folks. We're going to break for coffee. I'd like to thank the panel for an excellent session, and let's hope we keep them as part of the Content Delivery Summit. I'm going to keep them here by tooth and nail. So, okay. Well, we missed Microsoft. Never mind. We'll see them next year. Okay. Thanks, guys. We'll see you after the coffee break.